Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our morning meeting. What we had seen that the US market again yesterday saw some bounce back. Market is seeing in the US in trading in a range. S&P 500 upper range is 4390 and lower range is 4280. So it is trading within the range of around 110 points. Since last 6 days, what we had seen yesterday evening and today morning is that the bond yield, 10-year bond yield has again started moving up and moved up to 3-month high. Yesterday it moved up to 1.55 from 1.48. So that I think will have some concerns on the US market. What we see that market in the US continue to remain in a range considering this spike, and direction will be the key thing will be the how it takes the direction over there out of this range. So one need to be watchful of that. If you see the Asian market, Asian markets are indicating some negative trend, and even the US futures are also indicating negative trend. In the morning, New Zealand Central Bank has increased the interest rate. This is after third major country in this after this pandemic is taking interest rate increase to control inflation. Earlier, Norway and Korea has increased, and now the New Zealand. And apart from that, even we have RBI meeting on 8th as well. And no doubt there is no indication of any interest rate increase as of now for the Indian RBI, but there will be some concerns on increasing the energy prices in the recent past, and which can have an impact on the inflation, and the RBI may sound a bit cautious on that account. So one need to be watchful of that as well. Apart from that, in commodity, China continue to remain close in this week for their holiday. But oil continue to move up, and now it is at around 82.5, almost a dollar above yesterday. In LME, aluminiums and copper were, aluminium was flat and copper was marginally down by around 0.8%. Now I'll request technical team to take up from here.
Yeah, sir. Good morning, all of you. See, yesterday we see the positive momentum in index, and Nifty successfully closed above 17,800 level. But we see already Nifty in, trading in resistance zone, that is 17,800 to 17,900 in upper range. And we see last three trading session Nifty bounced back at important support zone, that is 17,450, 17,400 range. So we can see some volatility in upper range. And we see in the up and down at this level, maybe see some profit booking in higher range. If Nifty 1-2 trading session sustain this 17,800 level, then we expect further momentum towards 17,900 above, and again 18,000 in upper side. Downside, important support zone for 17,730-700 at downside. So we can keep watch Nifty today and tomorrow. If we sustain the 17,800, then we expect further momentum in market. Otherwise, Nifty trading the this range only. In downside, 17,700 below, then we expect further pressure in market, but we can see the level 17,700 and 17,900. This is Nifty 1-2 trading session is range. If Nifty break upper level, then we expect further momentum towards 18,000 and above level, but we expect some resistance at this level. So we can see the market trading the pressure, maybe see some profit booking in higher level. To keep stop loss, strict stop loss for all large cap, mid cap stock. Bank Nifty also trading near the resistance zone, that is 37,800 to 38,000 in upper side. So we can expect is Bank Nifty break this level and sustain the closing basis, then we expect further selling pressure. Downside immediate support place around 37,500 and 37,300 and 200 level at downside. We can keep stop loss at downside Bank Nifty 37,500. If below, then we expect some profit booking in higher level. So we expect today's both index and Bank Nifty open a flattish note, slightly negative. But first half, if sustain the importance support level, that is 17,800 for intraday, and Bank Nifty 37,750 is sustained, then we expect the second half market will be trading in higher range. That next important resistance level is 38,000 for Bank Nifty and 17,900 for Nifty. Nifty Finance also trading in upper range. And we expect next important resistance for Nifty Finance is 18,600, 18,730 in upside. Important support intraday place at 18,400. Below 18,400, it will drag towards 18,300 at downside. To keep watch this important level for Nifty Finance also. Today we expect positive momentum in IT sector. TCS Infosys looks positive for today's purpose. Auto stock also looks positive. Escort, already given call yesterday, looks positive for today. Negative side, cement, India cement looks weak at current level. So we can expect positive momentum in IT pack. Banking stock slightly negative, but wait for first half, then you can take a position for banking stock. But first half, we expect positive in IT sector. That's it for technical derivative I can carry.
Very good morning, everyone. This is Ayush Mehta. I'll be covering the derivative part for today. Let's start by analyzing the option chain. Starting with the call option data of Nifty, maximum open interest of around 22.5 lakh contracts was seen in 18,000 strike, which will be a very crucial resistance level for Nifty in the month of October. And we're also expecting some profit booking from those levels. Whereas intraday resistance for Nifty is placed at 17,900. Now, moving on to the put option data, it shows maximum open interest of around 32 lakh contracts at 17,000 strike, which will be the strong support zone for the Nifty in this month, followed by 17,500 strike, which is an important support level in this week. We will only witness a selling pressure if we see a closing below 17,500 levels. Also, 17,700 and 17,800 strikes are building major put writing positions, which will give more strength to the index. Yesterday, PCROI closed at 1.10, which is positive. If you look at the four major derivative data, which are open interest, PCR, FIIDI, India VIX, they all look positive. So overall, market scenario is positive. Markets will be volatile again when India VIX crosses 18. Now, moving on to the sector specific, we are expecting a short covering in private banks. Stock specific, Tata Motors and SBI looks positive and can move up. And security under ban is National Aluminium. That's all from my side. I request fundamental team to take the call forward.
Good morning. HDFC AMC has filed 9 exchange traded funds with SEBI. So this news is positive. The company has been losing market share primarily because of increasing share of ETFs. Over the last 5 years also, if we see, then around 7 out of 10 mutual funds has not been able to beat their benchmarks. So there is an industry shift which is gradually happening towards ETFs because they are low-cost funds as well and give you benchmark returns. Another example of among the new entrants, there is a mutual fund by the name of Navi, which is backed by Sachin Bansal, the former Flipkart founder. So even that fund has recently filed for 10 ETFs. So that is the industry trend. So positive for HDFC AMC. Bajaj Finance business update for Q2 was broadly in line. They posted healthy loan growth of 5% quarter on quarter. Year-on-year growth was 22%. If we adjust for the IPO financing book, which is a lumpy book, then quarter-on-quarter growth is 6.7%, which is good. Number of new loans booked by them was also at a seven-quarter high at 6.3 million loans. Although pre-pandemic, they used to do more than 7 million loans on a consistent basis, so still they have some distance to recover to that level. AU Small Finance Bank business update was also broadly in line. They also posted a loan growth of 5% quarter on quarter. Year-on-year, it was 32%. Collection efficiency continues to remain above 100% mark for 4 months now. And for September month, it was at 109%, which is a healthy sign. RBL Bank, on the other hand, the business was not very good for the September quarter. Loan book was flat both quarter on quarter as well as year on year, which is disappointing because the majority of the banks that have declared the business update have posted around 4% quarter on quarter growth. So negative for RBL Bank. That's it from my side. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Marico has came out with their Q2 business update. The company is expecting double-digit, low 20s growth in this quarter with double-digit volume growth. This is on the two-year CAGR basis because they are witnessing the improving demand trends as the mobility has increased and the consumption and of discretionary and out-of-home categories has increased. The international business is likely to deliver double-digit constant currency growth, except Vietnam, which has been affected due to severe COVID surge and stringent lockdown restrictions. However, on profitability front, the gross margins are expected to improve from the previous quarter, but under pressure on YoY basis due to higher input costs over the last year. Same wise, operating margin is also expected to contract on YoY basis. As a result, the company is expected to report modest bottom line growth in the quarter. So we believe that this is marginally positive for Merico as top line is expected to increase, the demand is increasing, but which is not getting reflected on the bottom line because of the higher input prices. Godrej Consumer has also came out with the business update, and what they're saying is that demand trends remain steady. At a consolidated level, Godrej Consumer expects to deliver high single-digit growth and 2-year CAGR of double-digit. However, operating margins are expected to contract during the quarter, driven by the lag between the rise in input price and increase in the end consumer pricing. They are expecting India business to deliver close to double-digit sales growth. So overall, we believe this is again negative to marginal positive because same like Merico, what we are seeing is that top line is increasing, but the margins are expected to contract because of the higher input prices. And this would take some time to get reflected on the profitability, the price increases, whatever the company has taken. Also, the international business of Godrej Consumer is not doing very well as Indonesia is still declining, and SAARC business is also likely to remain soft. That's it from me. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning. Jindal Steel and Power quarter two sales volume stood at 2.13 million ton, up by 32% sequentially and 10% year-on-year, driven by exports rising to more than 40% in the quarter as compared to 34% last quarter. Its Australian coking coal mine is now operational, which was closed for more than a year. And the first shipment is expected to be in November, in the month of November. This is positive for the company as it will reduce their coking coal dependency. Thank you.
So yesterday, few of the steel company also announced price increase. No doubt, this was very much expected and known in the market. The cost increase is quite low. Price increase is somewhere around 1500 to 2000 rupees, whereas the coke cost has increased substantially. So this price increase will be easily passed on to the customer. And the important thing is further price increase when the company takes, whether they are able to take in the current month itself or whether they will be taking the price increase towards the in the next month. So that will be more crucial, because this price increase is much lower than the cost increase for the companies. So nothing too so great in this price increase. Apart from that, Coal India has announced a diversification plan, or they had initially planned for a feasibility report whether to go into aluminium value chain, wherein they will be having from mining to final refined aluminium project. So they are in process of first preparing the feasibility report, and then only the decision will be taken. So it's very initial stage, so as such may not have major impact now. But if suppose this program get finalized company start investing in that project, then that can have some negative impact, as it is more of a diversification from their core business of coal. And second thing, the Coal India is mainly purchased for for dividend yield, which it can generate of around 9-10% dividend yield. At current price, it will be lesser, but the historical prices of around 140-150, it was generating yield of around 9-10%. So that yield, once the money is diverted to expansion of unrelated activity, then will have a negative impact on the dividend yield of the Coal India. So, sentimentally negative, but not immediately. It will take some time. Once the things finalize, then only the impact will be seen. Another important thing is Raymond Realty has announced the expansion plan. They have around 100 acre of land, and out of that around 20 acre land, they are already doing around 9 towers in Thane. And these towers are more of an affordable type, like 1 BHK, 2 BHK type of flats they were making. Now they had announced two premium projects, like one is retail and another is 3 and 4 BHK premium flats. So that will consume another, I think, around 20 acres of land. They got 100 out of that, 20 has already been used, and another 20 is now planned. So this is more of a, they will be putting up a rental assets as a retail mall will be opened, high-end retail mall. And that too looks very wide and large scale, considering 9.5 acre of land will be used in that. So I think that will be, since it will not be generating cash immediately once the mall comes, and then it will become more of an annuity income. So it will not be generating revenue like what has happened in sale of flat and all. So market may not take that as great positive. And apart from that, another which they had planned is 3 and 4 BHK high-end flats. So they are also, though the demand for those projects are comparatively good in current point of time, but we need to see how it progresses. Earlier, Raymond has announced a demerger of real estate business into a separate company, and the shares of that particular company was to be issued to the all minority shareholder as well. But a few days back, they had cancelled that program, and a lot of investor has come up with a negative view on that direction which company has taken. So overall direction-wise, what we feel that things are, this whatever they announced is more of a neutral, but overall outlook seems not so encouraging considering the corporate, the philosophy of the management. So that's all from us. Thank you very much and have a good day.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel for in-depth interviews of India Inc. and press the bell icon so that you do not miss our updates.